folks, my name is John Belinsky from See Me for Life. Our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. Now, what we're going to do is explore EKGs. We're going to do an 8-week program every Monday for 8 weeks. We're going to just post an EKG. It's going to be posted on Monday. And for those who like the process, you'll be provided the answers on Wednesdays. I'll try to provide moderate detail about the answers. Now, some rules about this are this is not designed to stir up any controversy. From some of the responses, there's some really smart EKG interpreters out there, and I can learn from you too. I am not by any way, shape, or form an end-all. I would like to share with you how I approach these in emergency medicine, and I sure welcome feedback and different approaches. Like cardiology PAs or nurse practitioners may approach this different than I would in an emergency room. So once again, feedback is great, contribution is great, but I don't want ego or controversy with these posts, or you're going to be blocked. Okay, we're going to boot you off of it. This is a 36-year-old female that I took care of. She was a smoker, smoked about a pack per day, 10-year smoker, and no other cardiac risk factors. She presented with 6 hours of palpitations that started while she was at work. She denies any excessive stimulants, no caffeine, or any recent weight loss. I was kind of pursuing thyroid disease. She feels a pressure in her chest, but I think I'm just anxious. And her initial EKG looks as follows. Okay. So this is the EKG that I wanted you to interpret over the next 2 days and to look at some of the problems with the EKG. Where do you isolate problems? How concerned are you at what you see? And listen, as you're watching this or listening to this, I want you to ask this question. On a scale from 1 to 10, how comfortable are you in interpreting this? Now, I can say when I first started working in emergency medicine, I was incredibly uncomfortable and not confident with EKGs, and it took me a good 2 years of clinical practice before I really felt confident. So if you look at this EKG, which we'll break down, I see elevations of V2 through V5 that really get my attention. That really is the basis of this EKG and the solution. Now, what I recommend doing whenever you look at an EKG is determine if it's sinus rhythm, and I recommend that by looking at the two boxes, lead 2 and AVR. If you have a positive P wave in lead 2 and a negative P wave in AVR, you can say with a high degree of confidence that this is indeed sinus rhythm, and it's not anything weird like limb lead reversal or dextrocardia. So right here, I will look at lead 2 and see where those blue arrows are pointing. Do I have upright P waves? And I'm not really going through a detailed interpretation of the P waves, just are they there and are they upright? Then I'll look at AVR. And are there inverted P waves? If there is, it's normal sinus rhythm, and that's what I concluded this rhythm strip was, normal sinus rhythm. Then I will look at high lateral lead. So look at one AVL, and do I see ST segment elevation, depression, or does it look okay? So when I take lead 1 and blow it up, my red line is the isoelectric line. And if you can't draw your baseline incredibly consistently, you're going to have a very difficult time interpreting 12 leads. No, it's impossible for you. You won't be able to interpret 12 leads if you can't draw that line. So where that blue line is pointing shows the ST segment. And I'm determining that although the T wave is flattened, which it may be of significance or not, we could look at electrolytes, I look at that lead and say the ST segment is on the line, so it's okay. It's not elevated, it's not depressed. I'm going to look at lead AVL. Same thing, my baseline is drawn in red, my blue shows that my baseline is right on the ST segment, therefore I'm not seeing any elevations or depression. So the high lateral wall looks good to me. The flattened T waves are notable, but overall I'm okay with that from an acute perspective. So now I'm going to look at the triangle. Those are your inferior leads. Lead 2, 3 AVF, they look at the right coronary artery feeding the inferior wall of your heart. So when I look at lead 3, I draw my line, and again I look at that the baseline is on the ST segment, so I don't see a big problem with that. I'm going to skip the other inferior leads, but I'm going to go to that box, that yellow box. Now, really what I'm doing is starting with V1 through V4, and I'm looking for any two leads in a row. Do they show me a problem? You have to be comfortable with the term contiguous. Are there two leads looking at the same area of the heart showing a problem? So we're going to go down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and let's start with lead V2. When I look at V2 and I draw my line, and I see some elevations there. I see some elevations. So my red line is my baseline, and there is some elevations above that. And I heard someone mention on the Facebook post, what about the PR depression? And you can clearly see PR depression here, which I don't think is a real detailed part of the conclusion here, but PR depression at times sure gets my attention when it comes to pericarditis. So could this be a pericarditis-like picture? But we'll talk about it. But clearly right now we have elevations that are in the anterior leads. So when I look at V4, I draw a line, I also see elevations there. So I have elevations that are in the anterior leads. Now, the way I teach in my system of 12 lead EKGs is there's six causes of ST segment elevation. Okay, and this is really the, I have mnemonics for everything on 12 leads, and this is one of the worst ones that I have, but you can clearly see a peanut butter sandwich and a frog. And that frog leaps over the ST segment elevation into the peanut butter sandwich. So that frog just leaped into the peanut butter sandwich. So I'm suggesting there's six causes of ST segment elevation. And this is a system that has never failed me running an ICU, running an emergency room, and taking care of a lot of really sick people. Leap PB is the mnemonic for the six causes of ST segment elevation. Left ventricular aneurysm, earlier polarization, acute myocardial infarction, Prinz metal, pericarditis, and bundles. Now, the left ventricular aneurysm, that's kind of a flag saying there's a couple other things that can cause some elevations, but this mnemonic has suited me quite well, and I've taught thousands of people this system. This EKG has me most suspicious of earlier polarization. Now, leap PB. You'll have to go through the mnemonic, but earlier polarization really is a diagnosis of exclusion, which means you rule out all the other ones, and when it's none of them, you can say this looks like earlier polarization. Now, the morphology, the convexity of the ST segment is helpful. So if you have two dots over the ST segment elevation and it's convex up, kind of gives you a smiley face, that's optimistic. He's happy, he's smiling. If you see a frowny face, that's more sinister of a morphology, but that's not the end all. It's helpful. The real key is diagnosis of exclusion. Now, the two safety nets always, and I'll give you specifics about this particular patient. One is, when you're in doubt, get someone else involved. Don't carry a coffin by yourself. Know when to phone a friend. I mean, even the docs do that. If they're not sure, they're going to fax it to a cardiologist. As advanced practitioners, PAs, nurse practitioners, show it to someone else. Get someone else's eyes on the EKG. That's your first step. I think that can sometimes be missed by PA or nurse practitioner instructors to say, embrace the relationship with your supervising collaborating doc. That's really why we're here, to have them help us. And I embrace that, and I feel pretty comfortable with 12 leads. The second thing is this. Okay, when it comes to chest pain on a timeline, let's just say it's 0 minutes. Someone has a significant amount of chest pain, but their EKG is normal. So when that yellow arrow shows heart within normal limits, it means the EKG isn't showing pathology, but there's 80% blockage, but they're having pain. Now at 50 minutes, let's say that blockage goes up to 90% and now there's ischemic changes. Then at 72 minutes, they go into a full infarction. Now the reason I'm showing this to you is because if you did an EKG where this red arrow is, let's say at 30 minutes, you would get the EKG before you found ischemic changes. If you repeated it again in an hour, then you'd get the ischemic changes. So something I stress, your two safety nets is one, get another set of eyes on the EKG, and number two is do serial EKGs. Now, this particular lady, her low cardiac risk factors made me feel this may not indeed be cardiac. That EKG, to me, looks like early repolarization, but that's not an end-all. Someone said as a Facebook post that it could be an early STEMI, and I absolutely agree with that. Absolutely. How do you rule that out? Well, you use serial EKGs because a STEMI will evolve, and I've seen a lot of STEMIs that present with just this hyperacute T wave, and they go into this elevation morphology that as you do serial EKGs, those reciprocal changes will pop out. So with this lady here, she was worked up. She did eventually go home, doing 4-hour troponins on her. So I watched her for 4 hours with a 4-hour pain-free interval, ruled out an acute MI. Serial EKGs did not show evolution, and I was confident that was early repolarization. But remember, you have to have a high degree of confidence reading your 12 leads. Do two EKGs. If you're not sure, phone a friend. You have to have a lot of confidence in how you interpret your 12 lead. Remember, 25% of all missed MIs come because the person misread the EKG. So folks, my name is John Belitsky from See Me for Life. My whole goal is to help you maximize your mind, and stay tuned for next Monday's EKG.